to pre-record it and then upload it, so you might even have it on the canvas for a recap, okay? So looking at it further during this week, I kind of feel that it might even be actually a better idea to use a JVC in your general practice over a DSLR. So I'm kind of sold on to the idea that the JVC would be a more professional option for you at this stage. There's a lot less fiddling about to do with screen shutting off and having to restart the record button and all kinds of stuff like that. You get basic buttons that are accessible for things like iris and shutter speed, white balance, and so on. So it's all pretty much out there ready for you to use. And the quality is really good. The lens is it's got a wide aperture, the built-in lens, and it's not too heavy. I think it's fine. With the extra lenses and kit you need to take with the DSLR, this option might be as good, or better actually, rather. Yeah?
There are a few different JVCs, either 150 or 600.
I'll introduce, don't worry. The other advantage the JVCs have is that there's direct XLR connection. Here you can see them. So you can hook up the microphone directly if you don't want to carry a Zoom with you, which I always advise to take one because you never know what happens. I mean, I would be paranoid to use just one stream of audio while recording anything important. So the Zoom basically gives you higher end sound and gives you that advantage of a backup recording from the main stereo mic. So I would still recommend using a Zoom, but you can also harness it on the shoe here as you would with a DSLR. The thing that's scary about these for taking them on the road is that they come with a massive bag. But I think if you ask at the MMC, they'll be able to provide a smaller bag for it. Ask them about it. Otherwise, the bags are big, but they're not very heavy, so they're quite easy to carry around. I did a project recently with two of these and one 5D, and I must say the footage coming from these was definitely very nice. So they are definitely a working solution. These are the JVC GY-HM600. You can see the model number. Where is it? Somewhere. Trust me on that for now. There's a booklet next to the loan counter. This booklet, it's a comprehensive manual how to use these. So you can grab one and take it home, study it. It's got all kinds of things like that can be handy later on, like a map of where things are on the camera, or how to do white balance, how to do iris, how to do a lens and aperture increase and so on, how to set up the audio gain. Everything's explained in there in quite a simple, easily accessible way. It's really a user reference manual kind of thing. It's not a massive manual to use. So you can take it with you on the road in case you get stuck. You can study it on the train or whatever. I'm going to follow this for today. So the first thing is a general introduction of the camera. It shoots in HD or SD. You can select. Of course, we would go for HD. 25 frames per second is our standard. And full HD, so 1080p. This side contains most of the buttons and the interface you need to know. It's got a very good lens that draws all the way to here, and the rest is sort of an operational interface. And of course there's a screen that comes out. This is your monitor, or you can use the viewfinder here. If you can't see anything on the viewfinder, you might most probably will need to switch the screen off. if when you flip the screen back, then you'll be able to see something in the viewfinder. Okay. They sometimes come with this wobbly thing, sometimes not. You might want to, if you need one, you might want to make sure that it's in there. Because I did take those a couple of times and they didn't have it. They only had the this sort of thing, which is less comfortable on the eye after a while. So yeah, on the top there's the regular sort of shoe to place your microphone, your flash or your, you know, zoom, whatever you want to put up there, whatever is possible. And on the bottom there's the usual standard tripod screw. The battery goes in here, so the other thing you need to make sure is that you have a battery coming with it. So these are the standard batteries. You get them usually charged. Take one extra at least. So two batteries always. So you can, you know, while using one of them, you can already charge the other one. Or, well, it depends on how long you're going to film for. But there's also in the bag a power cable, which if you're static and filming an interview somewhere, you might be able to connect that as well. But batteries are easy to handle, and they have loads of them in there. And they can give you 3, 4, 5, how many you need. So extra batteries is a good thing to have, but they're heavy, the only downside. In terms of the, okay, the record button is right here. So you can actually hold it like a handheld camera with this little harness here and access the record button with your thumb. That's the standard sort of professional camera situation. Or you might decide to hold it this way, and then you get everything here. So this is good for shooting, you know, on the go from below. If you want to run with somebody or get a lower position. This is the lens. There's a little switch here for opening up the lens cap. So we don't have to worry about losing the lens cap.
Tom, you can just pass me for the coffee, my coffee all day.
Yeah.
That's great.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
No problem. So to open the lens cap, you flip this up. This is your focus. Manual focus side of the lens. This is your this little handle here. You can see there's a handle. This is a zoom. It's very, very smooth. There's a bit of resistance. You're not gonna actually. That's one of the main advantages over the SLRs. Because zooming with an SLR kind of tends to jolt the whole camera, and like it's very hard to make a very smooth, subtle zoom. Whereas these are really designed for constant zooming and constant focusing. The zoom kind of buttons give you even more control with even less kind of motion, so you don't move the image about. You get a smoother image. This little button, this little roll, the last roll here behind the zoom, is an iris roll. What's also called iris or aperture. So that's a general adjustment for how much brightness you want in the picture. It sort of dams down or brightens up the whole picture. Down here, you see a couple of features you might not know. This is called an ND filter. This filter sort of darkens the lens. So in case in different stages, so there's like you can darken it a little bit, a bit more, a bit, or even further. The reason why we might want a filter that darkens the whole image is in order to, for example, if you're shooting in full sunlight and you want to get but you want to get the advantage of a very wide aperture, because a very wide aperture gives us
gives us
more light. But what else does it do in terms of the quality of the image if you shoot with a wide aperture?
Depth of field
gives you a narrow depth of field. Okay, the wider the aperture, the narrower the depth of field. It looks more cinematic. You get more kind of separation between the image you're focused on and the background. So if you want to get more focus on the person speaking, for example, and it's a bright sunny day and you don't want to see the wall behind them, just pop the ND filter on this thing here. Whoops. I would try it in stages and see what works in the actual situation. But then you can widen the aperture using this roll and zoom in a bit. And you'll get a nice sort of separation of background and figure. So that's an ND. That's the main use of an ND filter, actually, to create more kind of narrower depth of field. You have a button here for focus. You can switch between manual or auto. And there's a push auto in case you're in manual mode, like now. See, I'm in manual mode. Is it visible at all for the people in the back? Can you see that it's manual?
Yeah.
Okay. So this is manual mode. You can push auto. You can push this button, and it'll autofocus briefly for a moment, just like pressing the shutter in a DSLR. So if you're in manual mode and you've lost everything and you want to switch back in focus, you can just hit on this button and it'll switch back in focus. This is a button for setting the iris. So that's the general width of the aperture, like how much light there is. And again, you can do it. You have a push auto situation if you want to adjust the iris for the current situation in manual mode. This is the central sort of menu area. It looks like a DVD menu. That's pretty much the way it is, the hat switch. This would be the set or OK kind of button. This would be the down, up, left, right, as usual. And you get a cancel here. And what's this? Yeah, menu thumb. Okay, so that's a menu sort of button to pop up the menu. On the button here, very important buttons again, gain. So gain is another way of increasing brightness in your image. You rarely want to use this. The result is quite noisy. But in extreme situations, like shooting at night with no, you know, something close to night vision, because this is a very good lens for nighttime shooting as well. But if you don't have any light there, you want to really force the image to come out, you can use the gain. You get low gain, middle gain, or high gain. So low gain would be the default. That's the usual, the normal situation. Okay. There's two presets for aperture, for white balance. But you can also do your white balance manually. Let me show you briefly how it's done, because that's an important one. Does anyone have a white piece of paper? I might have one, actually. I've got something. So basically, to set up white balance, you need to, with this camera, you need to have something white with you. Ideally do it when full light shines on this white thing, or some kind of a full light. Preferably the light that's typical of the surrounding you're working in. So if there's natural light coming from outside, that light should shine on it. If there's artificial light there, then, you know, like here, neons. So ideally, this should be lit by the neon. Maybe I'll... Is there a quick way to switch the light on this? I'm not going to insist on that, but so we have a piece of white paper before the lens, and then what you need to do is push the white balance button here. Let me just double check that I'm doing this right, because it's a bit funny with this setup. What you get is this kind of sign here. So when you press the white balance button down here, when you press it once, you'll see there's a manual setting for it. That's the actual number. And when you press it another time, it's going to be on A, which is automatic. So if you want to do manual white balance, you want to get it to this number to show up. And then you want to use this button here. And this is the typical icon for white balance setup, okay? A ball with two triangles underneath it. So when you press it, it'll set up the white balance for you. Let's see if that works. Oops. Nope. Let's imagine I'm doing this correctly. Geometry is like freaking me out. But you can see that I'm getting a sign here that it's setting it up, and then I get another number. Okay, that's it. So all you have to do is make sure the white balance is not on automatic, but on manual. Put a paper next to it, and then press this button. It'll do it for you. Okay? Questions so far? Okay. So white balance is down here. You need to do this every time you go out shooting, okay? And in every environment you shoot in. So if you're shooting one interview in one room, another interview in another room, chances are they're lit differently. So you need to do a white balance for each surrounding, especially if the light changes. If it's exactly the same light and it looks all right, that's fine. But you need to do at least one at the beginning. Otherwise you'll get, you know, yellow tones, or you might get green tones or blue tones, and depending on the sort of the amount of skewedness in the color field. So these two buttons down here are for setting up the white balance. You have two presets. You can set them separately. So if you have two rooms and you're going back and forth between them, you can set up room one, set up room two, and then toggle back, so you don't need to reset every time. So that's A and B. And then there's a preset, which preset is like a sort of automatic kind of situation down here. That's your white balance. And then the shutter speed, something really important in the DSLRs, it's quite hard to set up. You can set up the shutter speed manually here, and you'll get it in the screen immediately, a display of what's your shutter speed. So shutter speed is now, whoops, sorry, wrong button. Shutter speed is now 1 divided by 25, which is what I want, 25 frames per second. One corresponds for the second. I toggle it again, it goes into automatic mode. And then you can see shutter speed keeps changing. Okay? So that's a way to compensate for low light. It will increase the shutters, decrease the shutter speed. If I do it manually, the shutter speed will stay constant. And I think that's a better situation. So 1 divided by 25 would be your desired shutter speed. If you want to change it, you click on the shutter here, and then you can go up to, and then with the up and down buttons here, you can change the amount of the speed, basically. Show you one more time. So shutter speed, and then up and down would change your speed accordingly. I'll show this on the screen now. Shutter speed, and going up and down. It's hard to see in the light here, but I'm toggling between different speeds, 25, 50, 100, 120, and so on. So 1 divided by 25 is our standard. If you need to, you can use 1 divided by 50 as well, but don't go above that if you can. Okay? Use other tricks to reduce light. Okay, so far we went from here to, from the lens to the area of the filters and the all those different controls, focus, iris, and the general menu. That's down here below, gain, white balance, and shutter speed. These are less important for us. Down here, if we continue, you can flick this on full auto if you want, fully automated filming. I don't recommend, but you know, sometimes you have no option to focus on anything because you really need to be, you're alone, you really need to focus on your interview, you need to follow somebody and not fall over, and you're the reporter and the camera person. It might be more convenient to use fully automated settings. I would usually recommend to try and learn how to control these, especially if you have a constant shutter speed and you have a constant frame rate, then working constant ISO, then working with the aperture, changing the aperture would be the best way to adjust your settings so it looks the best. if we continue, so we're out of fully automated filming, and we go into, this is AE lock, which means automatic exposure lock. So when you're in automatic mode, you have automatic, well, actually on top of your settings, you can adjust the automatic exposure, which at this point I forgot where it is, but I'll find it in a second. But automatic exposure is basically the general degree of brightness of the frame. So regardless of your settings, you can add more brightness or reduce some brightness using AE, automatic exposure. So this button here locks the automatic exposure, which is quite handy when you're filming automatically. Because, for example, you might want to do a pan around the room. And if you didn't lock the automatic exposure, the exposure would change for any area of the room because they're lit differently. There might be a window, suddenly exposure goes down. There might be less light, exposure goes up. So seeing a pan across the room where the lighting of the frame constantly changes looks very unprofessional. So you can do a pan whilst holding AE lock.
So you have to hold it then?
To hold it, yeah. Because it suspends the automation for a moment. So you capture the light and then do your pan and then release it. Zebra, actually, it might be a toggle. Wait a minute. Is it a toggle or? Just gonna double check so I don't confuse you. I'm going to look for a solution. I'm not entirely sure if it's a brief one, if it's a momentary one or a toggle. Might be a toggle. Zebra is those stripes. Have you ever come across these kind of stripe when you have a lot of light in a viewfinder? You get these stripy image. See if we can mimic that now. Yeah. might be difficult to see here. I'm not sure if we'll manage to get it fully working here, but you can see a little bit. Okay, it's hard to see it through the from my laptop camera. But what I see now is actually this whole area of the paper is stripy. You get stripes on it. And what zebra lines indicate is overexposure. Okay, so if you're filming with such settings that the brighter areas of your frame are overexposed, meaning burnt, as in you lose all the content or all the details there because they're overexposed, it indicates that for you. So you can, you know, you might not be able to trace that visually, but it tells you what is overexposed, so you can adjust the exposure so you get a more rounded image, which then later on you can always add brightness to. But it's better to, well, you know, within reason. Sometimes your sky might be extremely bright, but you want to film the good light for the for people's faces, which happened once, for example, when someone was filming the Tyne ferry, and there were beautiful images of the ferries going into the horizon. Everything was overexposed, but obviously the sky is so bright that it would be overexposed. So Zebra lets you control the indicator whether things are overexposed or not. Marker allows you to set markers while you're filming. So, you know, markers on the frame. I've never used this, so I wouldn't know what to recommend regarding using markers. Okay, so that's your I'm gonna skip on this one. You can read about it in the manual if you want. So this is the kind of filming area. This is the stuff you need for filming. You'll be glad to know that unlike a DSLR, this one has a slot for two SD cards of 32 gigs. So it goes seamlessly from one to the other. So if you went over your SD card, it'll go to the next one. There's a bunch of slots here as well. You can, see the image directly through HDMI. You can connect it to the computer to import stuff or to view the screen in live mode. There's some AV controls, like a remote control for audio visual settings. We don't have it with the kit, so don't know if that's useful for anyone. And this is the DC input. This is the input where you put in the power supply if you need to. Once again, the record button one is here, and you can also zoom back and forth here. There's another record button up here, and you can zoom back and forth using this little handle. This little handle is a lot more sensitive than the bigger handle. Less sensitive handle is sometimes better than the more sensitive handle because, again, in most cases, you want the zoom to be almost unnoticeable, like very, you know, seamless kind of zoom. So this gives you kind of fine control over little details without too much change. By the way, you can see the settings changing on my laptop camera all the time when I'm moving around. So this is the kind of unprofessional situation we want to avoid with automated settings. Let's move on to, on this side of the the top zoom, the top zoom toggle, what's good about it is that it's highly sensitive. If you press it, if you press more, it'll zoom quicker. If you press less, it'll zoom slower. So it's a highly sensitive button. It's more sensitive than this one. And you can set the settings for it here on the switch. You can set between fixed zoom speed, which means there's no sensitivity in the zoom, and variable zoom speed, which means you can do quicker or slower zooms, and completely off, which means the zoom here doesn't work at all. Okay, so that's an important toggle down here. One more thing, the to one more time, just to repeat the releasing the battery. It's kind of stuck in here. You need to press this button above it, little button. Hit it and then pull it up so it will release on its own. Okay. And then pushing it in would be pushing it in and gently driving it downwards. Okay, something about audio. So we've got two channels here, both XLR. you can connect your mic.
Tom.
Yeah.
I just heard you. I noticed quite a few of you looking at your phones and things. Could you just try and pay special attention, because particularly this thing about the sound is really quite difficult, quite hard to get. So, sorry. I'm not saying, but just try and give your full attention, as much as you can, because it's not easy.
Maybe I'll add to this that doing multiple training is a good idea. Not with me, but one with me and one with David, for example, or Matt, whoever is doing the training. But most of all, filming. I mean, taking it out and filming yourself. Trial and error. I think that's the best way. Not only when you're on assignment, also just filming to get to know the camera. Okay? I mean, usually you'll end up with quite straightforward work environment. It'll be just... you'll have the settings pretty regular, constant, and just film. But yeah, I agree with Ian. Do pay attention. But if you're not sure about something, you can ask me, and I will also post this on the Canvas, so you can listen again if you have the energy. I don't think I would. Okay, this here is a seat for your mic, so you can let it out of its little handle. Unscrew this part. Put the mic in there. And screw it back in. Okay. So now we have a microphone that's actually attached to the camera. You then want to connect it directly to the input. So this goes in. You need a shorter cable for that, of course. Just a short male-to-female XLR cable. And we can connect it to input number one, for example. And we have... basically, what would happen is, by default, the sound would be coming from this microphone that's built into the camera, here in the front. As soon as you connect one microphone into the right-hand channel, it'll be swapped with one of the channels of the microphone, the internal one. So you get half an internal mic and half, I think.
Does it matter which one you plug it into?
No.
Does it have to be one first?
Or? No. So once I've plugged in my mic, I should say, one thing about the settings of this mic. It's a good idea to, and I've seen this with a couple of projects. There's a toggle here. Straight line and a wonky line. Take the wonky one. Okay. So it's better to have it switched on to the... this is called a bass cut. So the one that's warped. It's a bass cut, meaning all those small handling of the mic, cable noises, everything that comes from the handle and from moving the camera, wind blows. It usually comes into the lower frequencies. So you get this kind of bass thumps. They get cut out, so you get more focused kind of sound. So I'd recommend to just keep it on bass cut regularly. Unless you're going to record a gig and there's a lot of bass you want to capture in it. But this is really about sub-bass. It's really about bass that's hardly ever there in our usual communication.
Sorry, Tom, which symbol was bass cut?
The bass cut was the non-straight line. So straight line is no bass cut,
okay, so
and the one that's straight and then curved is the bass cut.
What's the range of that mic, Tom? What's a good range of that one?
I haven't seen the curvature for this one. Typically, the range, typically any audible device would give you no less than 20 hertz to, well, 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. This specific, each mic has its own sort of characteristics, which means it might emphasize certain areas of the frequency domain. For that, you need to look at the manual for each of the mics. They often have a non-linear kind of curve because that's more consistent with how we hear. So it's not necessary that you want a completely straight objective mic. You might want to have a mic that actually beautifies things a little bit for the voice, for example. But this is a very good mic. It's a Sennheiser. Sorry, it's a Rode. No, that's a Sennheiser, isn't it? Regardless, whether it's a Rode or a Sennheiser, they're all going to have this bass cut option. So I would put that up.
Is there a toggle there?
Yes, there is. You need to reach into it with a pen or something. Okay. It needs a sharp object to handle. So I've connected into input one. Then I flip back to the other side of the handle. And you can see here there's a bunch of settings. Channel one, channel two, input one, input two. So channel one, channel two, this is just a general routing situation. You need to select between internal mic, which is the mic that's already built in, and the external one. So I'm sorry, I said it flips, it changes automatically. It doesn't. So you need to connect it and then select in channel one that I want to get input two coming from it. Now, it sometimes happened to some of our later year students that they went out filming without an additional mic or with an additional mic, but they got no sound. Absolutely no sound. And the reason is because they haven't selected. So if you have no microphone connected to the camera, just go as is. But let's say channel one and channel two are both selected to input one and input two, you just get noise because it's coming from the sockets. It's not coming from any mic. So if you're not connecting any mic to it, you need to make sure you're in internal, INT. It's like strange way to write that in, but INT would be the internal mic. Okay. Input one would be jack, would be XLR one. Input two would be XLR two. And you can actually swap between the channels if you want. You can play around with it. This is like a routing system. You can also set this, once again contradicting myself, you can also set this to automatic, and then it's done for you. So either manual or automatic switching between the channels, all right? We live and learn. This is your gain settings for the microphones. They're on zero at the moment. You really don't want them to be on zero when you're filming, because then again, you won't get any noise, any sound. So you need to make sure you're setting those, just like you do in the Zoom, I would say between 5 and 6 to start with. And there's a way to look at the incoming signal on the screen when you're filming. So I'll show you how to do this in a sec. Input one and input two both have switches, selectors for what kind of level you want to set them to be. It can be line level, which is the top one, which means if you're getting feed from a mixer, or if you're, you know, directly feeding from the Zoom into this, which has a preamp already. Basically, every microphone has to have some sort of amplification. Some microphones need more amplification than others. And if you put the microphone into some device, like the Zoom or like a mixer, anything, any device where you can set the volume, usually gives it some amplification as well. So you can use the line level amplification if you're connecting after another device, after a mixer or after a Zoom. Usually you will actually use the mic amplification level. So there's microphone amplification, which is fine for any normal microphone, except if it's a condenser like this one right here. So gunshot mics have internal batteries. And the internal batteries give them that extra amplification. It's called phantom. So they give it to the mic. Sometimes you might run out of battery, or some of them don't have batteries in them, because people tend to use them in a different way. You can use them without the battery by flipping into 48, into the bottom one. So mic 48, mic plus 48V, which is the phantom boost. So this channel, the plugs themselves can amplify the microphone without any need for batteries or for phantom. So in case you're without batteries or whatever, you can still use it using the phantom boost. In most cases, I think using the bottom one would be it would be best for a gunshot mic situation. But have a try, okay? Have a try, have a listen, see that it works for you, because each mic is slightly different. And if you're not sure, you can ask also at the counter before, when you get a certain kit, if you need phantom for this mic or not. Okay? Questions so far? This is like a surgery.
You might be getting to it, but is there a headphone jack to sort of?
Yes, there is. Yes, good point. I might have forgotten, but for these kind of questions, actually, take the manual with you. Okay, take one from the loan counter, and so you can have a map on there where you can read actually. Where was it again?
16.
16, thank you very much. Headphone jack, there we go. So that's on the right-hand side. The numbers are so small, I can hardly see them. Can you see where 16 is? Yeah. There it is. Okay. So that's up here. It's a little compartment I didn't show you yet. Up here, there's a little compartment that you can open. It has a headphones and an auxiliary socket. Okay? So that's where you connect your headphones, and you can also connect it to an external recording device. So if you wanted to take the Zoom with you and record another backup of your sound, for example, just in case something goes wrong, you can do that. Okay, so we went through shooting area, we went through the audio section, and now we're into monitor. When you have your headphones connected, you can choose what channels you're listening to. You can listen to channel 1 if you have only one mic. You can listen to channel 2 if you have another mic, or if you want to toggle between them to hear what each mic is saying. Or you can listen to both, like a mix of both, which is, of course, the default situation. You can change the volume of your monitor. Your headphone volume is here. So it's unintuitively on this panel rather than next to the headphones jack. The other thing we have here is LCD back brightness for your LCD for this. Peaking, I think that shows you the audio peaking, if you have audio peak levels. Display, what does display do? Okay, yeah, display is an important button, actually. Display gives you toggles between different display situations which you might want to have in the field. Okay? So you might want to have more information or less information on your viewfinder when you're filming, because you'll see less of the image behind it, of course. So this is a minimal display. You can see the audio levels, which is very handy. So you constantly see them on the top, on the bottom left. And you can see general things like how long have I been filming for, what's the date, what are my general settings like aperture, and white balance and so on. Or you can go into more extensive mode where you also see the HD format and you see exactly how many minutes gone by and so on. And how many minutes you have left on battery, which is quite important as well. Okay, so yeah, you might want to flick between them a couple of times when you, while you're filming, if you're just doing the filming. But this is quite handy to have. And then status. That's just a general sort of indicator for or summary of the status of your camera. All kinds of different things in your settings, including the file format you're recording to, which by default should be QuickTime H.264, and that's the format you should be filming for as well, filming to. QuickTime H.264, 1920 by 1080, 25p. P is progressive, meaning that the full frame gets updated every time. 16 by 9 would be, I think, would be advisable for Winold. A couple of things about the menu. So, if we put the menu up, so I put the I display the menu by pressing this button here, menu. Here we go. So the camera functions is where you can change your media format. So the format you're writing to. It's a bit hard to see here, but this is sorry, let me just recap on this. Sorry, in the menu, go back to menu. You go back with cancel and you press menu to go there. Going into camera functions, it's the first one. And then to, I think it was system, wasn't it? No, sorry, going down to system, that's below a few steps. And then into record settings, which is the above one, the top one. And there you can see the recording format. The recording format should be QuickTime H.264 HD. Make sure it's HD. Don't shoot in SD. SD is standard definition. HD is high definition. It's a much better resolution. And then 1920 by 1080p, 25p. And that's it. Any questions? Any questions about, well, do you want to do some practice with it now, or would you rather put this into practice?